You're still watching The Pulse on the Joy News channel on Multi TV, and with just some 5 months to go before the 2016 elections, it's time to bring you another candidate who will be coming to you, be it your home or at a campaign rally, to ask for your votes. We want to see what she has for us and why you should be voting for her today. She's been arguably one of the most revered and respected first ladies of Ghana in its 59-year history. Known for her suave and elegance at first glance and her strong personality, many won't think twice in calling her a woman of the Ya Asantewaa breed. She has been in the limelight, known for her women's rights activism and a firm believer of probity and accountability. But with less than 5 months to the elections, she is on a mission to become Ghana's first female president. Is she ready? What is her big vision for this country? And why should a Ghanaian voter choose her above all the other options to lead the nation for the next 4 years? My guest is Nana Konadu Agyemang Rawlings, Flagbearer of the National Democratic Party. Welcome to the program, madam.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us here
on
the program.
Thank you for having me.
I guess we can start with you, the personality Nana Konadu Agyemang Rawlings. Arguably one of the very well-known and respected first ladies. Mm-hmm. Do you miss being first lady?
Well, it depends on what you mean. In the sense that I miss it because of the trappings, no, I don't, because okay. there was no trappings. But in the sense that you can actually get support from external organizations to come and help the women of Ghana and the children of Ghana, yes, in some ways, I do.
Okay.
But I think that generally I'm getting on with what I have to do, and that's it.
Okay. Yeah. Now, in the years you've been on Earth, before politics, did you always think that you'd be a politician today? Looking back on your life?
My life has been political, very much so. Because from the time of growing up, we had political people in the household. We had, my father had people from both disciplines. We had members of the CPP group who were members of his family, brothers and sisters. And we had members of the UP group who were members of his family, brothers and sisters and uncles and so on. So the household was a very political household. So there's no way that I could have escaped it.
So you're saying that even before you got married to Mr. Rawlings, you mm-hmm. always had it in mind to be a politician?
Not that I had it in mind to be a politician. Mm. I was brought up in a political home. So politics was part of our everyday life. Mm. They quarrel, they argue, but when it comes to sitting down to eat, they are still discussing what is best for the country. So, yes.
Okay. Now, before NDP, you were a politician of another breed. And by that I mean being such a strong pillar in the NDC. Mm. Now, if you look back in your time with the NDC, do you have any regrets?
I don't think so.
At all?
No, I don't think so. I don't have regrets in... You see, I can look at it from two angles. If I'm talking about regrets based on maybe some remunerations or something that we're doing that I was benefiting from, no, I have no regrets because there was nothing to benefit from. But regrets in the sense that you have a road that you are on, you're leading in a way to prosperity for the people of Ghana, you're leading, you are on a train, let's say, and you are moving from place to place, level to level, making sure that wherever you pass, you leave something good behind. And suddenly I see that it's turned the other way around, it's going backwards, and so it's destroying the things that have been built. In that respect, yes, there is some regret.
Okay,
but otherwise, no regret.
We will discuss the NDC as it is and as it was before.
I don't know if I want to be here to talk about NDC.
Okay,
I want
not
to talk
about NDC,
NDP.
But about where you've been, your political journey in its totality. But your decision to be a member of the NDC before, was it a personal decision or it was one born out of your close ties with Mr. Rawlings?
I didn't join the NDC. I helped to build the NDC. So there are two different things.
Okay.
I didn't join. So because some of us were not CPP or UP or anything. And the rest of them were like, well, those of us who belong to some other group, we're going back to our grouping. But for those of you who have nowhere to go, well, that's your problem. Mm. So then we sat back and said, okay, in that case, let's build something that is revolutionary. So that's what we did.
Why revolutionary?
Revolutionary so that we can actually change from just politicking to working towards making people better in Ghana. And that's different from just politicking, you know.
Okay. So at the time, there was a vision for the party, the NDC. You were part of the building of this party. Mm-hmm. What were these key tenets or the key pillars?
I didn't come
for the
here
party?
To really come and talk about NDC and build them up. I want to talk about the NDP.
We will in just a moment.
Yeah,
I just want to understand your
political
journey.
I'm sure you do understand it. That's they were going on a certain road and they've really turned left and backwards.
Okay.
So I don't want to go into that because I want to look forward into NDP and work.
And we will. You see, people want to appreciate where
are
you've
you
come from
don't?
To where you are. Well, there are some who may be watching you for the very first time and may not know.
Mm.
We may take it for granted,
I
but some may not
know.
I hate
to do publicity for another party.
I
honestly do.
I understand.
But we built the party based on the ideologies of my husband, looking at the way he believed in the country Ghana, that we could all be a part of, you know, decision making. And take ourselves from the quagmire of poverty into prosperity, and then reduce corruption and stealing and unnecessary bickering in the country, develop every part of the country so that, you know, no matter what levels we are at or we are in, we will still slowly be developing, irrespective of where we live. And so there were basic things that we took from the PNDC. And then try to push it into that party at that time.
Okay. So what? Today's NDC is a pale shadow of what you created before.
I'm not sure whether it's even a pale shadow. It's a contradiction.
A contradiction?
Total contradiction.
Explain. I don't understand.
A contradiction is when you have something that you want to go here, you put it here, and you're moving in that direction. When you want to contradict it, and move in the opposite direction.
Is it the people or the beliefs?
I think that you have to start with the people. Because it's the people who activate and actualize suggestions and, you know, objectives. So if the people there are not believers in the objectives, then it definitely is not going to happen.
So by people, you mean the executives of today?
I don't have to go into the nitty-gritty.
Why not?
Because I want to talk about the NDP.
And you will, madam, in just a moment.
You're taking too much of my time. It's 1 hour.
No problem.
I'm interested in
One day, invite
me and say the topic is NDC.
And we will have that conversation.
Then we'll have that conversation.
Okay.
But for the moment...
Indulge me for 5 minutes more. Still on this one. Then I'll give you enough time for the NDP. We'll delve with it in its totality from its formation to the end.
I know you won't, but I'll take it anyway. You're just like my son.
No. I will, I promise. But with the NDC, I just want to understand something. What will ever make you consider rejoining the NDC? Is there any possibility like that?
What's your name again?
Francis.
Francis. Whenever I go on a show, I tell my interviewer that I really don't like to use hypothetical situations.
Okay, no hypothesis.
No hypothesis to
will
give
you
a hypothetical
join?
Answer. I don't want to do if.
Okay, will you ever rejoin?
That is if. It's an if. Will you? That's a hypothetical question.
Mm.
And I'm not going to answer hypothetical questions, no.
Okay, all right. So, Mr. Rawlings, your husband, is one of the founding members of the NDC. You also were before.
Actually, you know what?
Yeah.
These days, I hear them saying, as one of the founding members.
Yeah.
He is not one of the founding members. He's the founder. We made him the founder as we were building the party. So anybody who says he's one of the founding members, it means they want to reduce him to the level of founding members. He wasn't part of the founding member.
Okay.
He's a founder.
So the founder of the party, NDC, Mr. Rawlings, created this party with your support at the time, the NDC of that time. Today you say it's a contradiction, total contradiction. How does he feel about it? You are with him very closely almost every single day, so you know better than all of us. How does he feel about it?
I think he sees the contradictions as well. he is an optimist. He thinks he can stay in and change it and improve it. So let's see.
I think
that he thinks he can, he hopes to be able to correct things. Mm.
Is that not something you will have helped him to do? Considering that you started it with him.
You know, I have reached a point where I am building something called the NDP mm-hmm. that has his values.
Okay.
I don't have to go back and look for anything. They have his values. We're looking at restoring participatory democracy. We're looking at restoring, you know, probity and accountability. We're looking at making sure that the people of Ghana look forward to something, look after something, look after somebody. Mm-hmm. So I am not going back to see if I can catch some little worm or some little fish in some water that I can't even see. It's just, you know, I am moving on to make sure that his principles are clearly spelled out in this party.
And so you've left the job for him to do alone?
I didn't say I've left a job for him to do. He's the founder. Mm-hmm. He doesn't have to do the work.
Someone else has to.
He doesn't have to do the work. I mean, he is the founder. And when you are a founder of an organization, if you are the Asantehene, if I may use my cousin's example, mm-hmm. you don't go down to the nitty-gritty and start to solve the problems, no. The big things are brought before you.
Okay, all right. Let's quickly talk about your family before we move to the NDP. The Rawlings' family. I mean, it's one family that many who mention it get very nostalgic about it, that mm-hmm. it's one family that's given birth to two political parties. You say that you already come from a political family, even before the Rawlings is. Mm-hmm. So what kind of conversations go on in your home? Is it all politics?
It's not all politics. It's about welfare. It's about everyday life, environment, our lives, our love. It's about everything. You can't just talk about politics and talk about nothing else. Even as I say that I'm from a political family, mm. I do not restrict it to one political family. I'm just saying that I am from a political family, so we're very versatile. Whether it was a military government or a partisan government, my father was always being called to be part of something. You know, so he actually brought people into the household that made it easier for us to discuss anything and everything.
Okay.
So even as the brothers and so on may be arguing about issues, there comes a time when it's time to eat or something, they're talking about the welfare of the country, the welfare of the people. So yes, that is possible.
What's a regular day in your family like?
Depends what you mean.
I mean in the Rawlings' family, in your home.
It still depends on what you mean. If I wake up in the morning, mm-hmm. first thing I do is to have maybe my 10 minutes exercise.
Okay.
Then I get ready and go to work. Invariably, I don't eat breakfast because I don't want to be caught in the traffic. So I rush off to work, and when I get to work, I eat something. I don't get back till late. So when you say the Rawlings family, you're assuming that all the children are staying in the city. I mean, there are no more children. They hear me, they'll kill me. I didn't say that. our children are not necessarily waiting for us to do stuff with them. Mm-hmm. Everybody has their lives. So I go to work. I'm here today. Tomorrow I'm somewhere else. I'm busy working on projects with the 31st or looking at issues of the NDP. So by the time I get home, I'm pretty much tired. Mm. Or I still go to the gym during the around 5 o'clock for about an hour.
And then so you love keeping fit, that plus work. That's your regular day?
I'm a fun person too.
Okay. What do you do?
Me, I dance a lot.
Okay.
I dance, I swim.
All of that. We'll come to that in a bit. But you're saying that now it's just you and Mr. Rawlings at home, the kids are all out.
I didn't say that. I said it's as if we do everything with them.
Okay.
I cannot say we do things with them.
Okay.
Uh-huh. That's what I'm saying.
Okay.
They have their lives. Everybody moves on.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
It doesn't mean they don't live in the house. Mm. Yeah.
As a mother, what's been your cardinal principle in raising your children?
Good upbringing. Your yes must be yes, your no is no. Right is right, wrong is wrong. Forthrightness, boldness. And last but not the least, respect for the system, the adults, and traditional things, you know, the environment, respect for those things.
Is this something you see around today, or it's something that's missing these days?
To some extent, it's missing. And it kills me. I mean, it breaks my heart. Because I think that we all were brought up in, well, not all of us, but those of us who are old enough, were brought up in a situation that made us very respectful to our adults. There's no way that as a young person, I can walk through that door and I see an older person come in. I will not step back and wait for the older person to pass. No way. It's the same with my children. If somebody is coming through the door older than they are not going through the door pushing their way past. No. They'll step back, the person will come in, they'll greet the person, and that's it. I think those things are missing these days, and we've got to bring them back. Because it's not just our culture, but it's a form of training to have a type of discipline in your life. And that discipline is very important if you want to grow up to be a normal human being.
Okay. Yeah. That's for Mrs. Rawlings, the mother. I get that part. Nice. Let's now move on to your party, the NDP.
Oh, you've taken a long time to get there.
but we're there now.
We're there.
So I guess we can ease up on the NDP. First of all, I want to understand what informed the creation of this party, NDP?
The same thing that you talked about earlier, in the sense that the principles that we started with from in the other party, and the principles that my husband, who said, you know, we should all be part of decision making, and why we should be part of decision making, and what he started had been thrown into the garbage. And so we're looking at restoring probity and accountability. Since these days, you don't see much of it in governance. We're looking at restoring participatory democracy, because if we have participatory democracy, that is when the assemblies will work well. And if the assemblies work well, then a lot of the issues that are happening today, like garbage and, you know, bringing people from Accra to build schools in small villages, when the people in that village have carpenters, they have masons, they have civil engineers, they have people who can actually help to build it, even if you give them the design and the money and supervise them, so that money rotates within the districts. And then it makes it easier to collect your taxes. Because when there are no taxes coming from the districts, it means that central government should take care of every district. And that definitely negates decentralization. And so these are things that we were looking at, and bringing people more on board to make sure that if we are able to push the NDP agenda, Ghanaians will be better off, not only economically, but in the safety of their lives as well.
Okay, so and again, listening to the things you say about the tenets for which reason you created the NDP, I've heard some say that there's quite a very thin line if you look at the formation and the very many ideas that created the NDC and the NDP. Both almost look the same. So doesn't it confuse the ordinary Ghanaian looking at the two parties?
The only Ghanaian who will get confused is the one who's already corrupt. They are the only ones who get confused. Anybody else who has their heads really screwed on well will look at the two parties and say, yes, we can see that these people want to follow a level of probity and accountability and participatory democracy and the other things, you know, ensuring good accountability of our resources, as against those who have come and captured the other party and have actually catapulted it as well and capsized it in such a way that they are running it the way they want.
Who are the ones who've captured
it? I don't want to mention their names. They are not so important to me.
But why not?
I want to talk. I don't, because you see, let me tell you. I'm an expert in what you call the hidden persuader. And that's advertising. So, if I don't like you, I'm not going to advertise you. Because I don't care what you wear. I don't care what you say. I'll go somewhere else and maybe deal with it so that you come down further. I won't sit here and propagate you. Mm. I definitely will not. So that's why.
So your bid is to promote the NDP, make it
absolutely
a viable, credible option,
yes,
for voters today, mm-hmm, and make NDC less of a party.
And
make NDC less of a party. Reduce in terms of its weight and,
you know,
prominence.
Don't put it this way. If you put it that way, mm, you're being so myopic. And I don't believe that this is your own mind. However, you must put it in a way that will enhance the NDP and put everybody else behind us. The arrow is this way, and the arrow is the NDP.
Okay,
the head
is NDP. So in the run up to the 2012 elections, mm, the NDP was created. We didn't get the chance to vote for the NDP because you did not make it past the EC's regulations for the elections. Why is that? What happened?
Every time I'm asked this question, then I'm like, start hating myself. I should have brought my book. I have a copy of the document that the EC rejected. Mm. And I make copies of everything that I submit just to put it down for historical, you know, for history's sake. And so when the head of the, I think the chairman was flicking through the, you know, literally, that was not my document. If I show you my document, you will have to look to see which parts had not been signed, and you see that, you know, some road somewhere in Bunkrunku, and the people said there's no road, it's just a path. It has no name. So we cannot put a name. All those little things are the ones that he used against me. But we all know that it was not that. So it's okay.
I don't know.
You do.
I don't. What was it?
Joseph.
No, I'm Francis.
I'm Francis. I'll change your name.
I don't know. What is it?
So, in effect, I was taken out of it for no good reason.
The EC did that?
Yes, the chairman of the EC. Because until then, you could not say, I have disqualified somebody. Because I know for a fact there were parties that hadn't done their papers properly. And they gave them a week, 2 weeks to go and finish it up and bring it. They did those things for them. So why did he not do that for me, even if he said I had done the wrong thing, which he knew I hadn't done?
So you think the tables were tipped against you, deliberately?
I'm not sure even if the tables were tipped. One person was tipped against me, and he followed the line. That's it.
I see. Okay, so fast forward now to 2016. You've got all the processes done, haven't you?
Yes, we have. We have everything done. We're waiting for the EC to print out the documents again, mm, so that we can pick the document,
okay,
and start filling them.
How many candidates are running parliamentary for the NDP?
That we have not decided yet, because we've asked them to do it regionally. Oh, not that we haven't decided. We've asked them to tabulate regionally, and we haven't got the composite number yet.
But are you not racing against time, considering that you just have
less than five months? And we want them to actually, for example, if there are six people applying for one constituency, you don't expect us to bring all of them. Mm. So we've asked the regions to actually sieve out and bring the best. But they want them to give us three of the best, you know, one, two, three. And then, especially if there are many, and then we will look at the three and say, okay, Mr. X is better or Madam Y is better.
And I ask that because whatever process this is, when you're done, there's still very limited time to market whoever it is for the election.
No, they're marketing themselves now.
Individually?
Oh, no, as a region, and as a district, and as a constituency. They're doing that now. It's not that we're waiting. No. We're not waiting. Because you don't hear from us, right?
So how many seats are you targeting?
There are 200 and something.
275
seats. And I'm not saying we're going to field one everywhere, because we're going to look at the strength of the person and see if they have the capacity to win. And those are the areas that we'll support them.
Because one of the reasons I asked that question about parliamentary seats and which ones you're going for is that whichever candidate seeks to win an election presidential will need the backing in parliament to put through his views and visions for the country. So if you don't have the strong arm in parliament, how do you intend doing it?
Well, Francis, you know why it's important not to just get your house full of your parliamentarians? Because even when you're going wrong, they don't tell you anything. If you have a parliament that has, you know, different views, and you don't have a majority, let's say I don't have a majority, so it means that I should tap from all the others. It means I should actually talk to the other party leaders, and we come to a consensus, and they actually say, okay, this person will be good for this, this person will be good. We want people who will actually help to build Ghana, not because I have 200 and something people in my, you know, on my parliamentary list, so I do what I like, which is what has been happening for some time. We've got to move away from it. For me, it doesn't matter. It's Ghana first.
Okay, so it means that you'd be willing to get few seats in parliament, minority in parliament, but even, that is, if you are able to win the elections, you'll be able to work with whoever it is
in
parliament.
Absolutely. But good people.
But will that
not
be
just
difficult?
Whoever. Don't say whoever it is in parliament. Mm. The good people in parliament, we should be able to tap into their expertise.
Okay. Yeah. Now, final point on your preparations as a party before we move to the general picture here. For the NDP, what's the grand plan here? Are you into win first round? Are you into push it to a runoff? What is it?
I'm not a magician.
Of course you're not.
But we are working towards winning. But I'm not a magician. We're working towards winning. Who knows? We are working hard on the ground. So trust me.
You will win.
You will have a miracle on your hands.
A miracle?
Yes.
What makes you so sure?
Because I know it. When we go out, I feel it.
But I'm sure there are many politicians who say they feel the same thing as
well. But that's what politics is about. You have to be sure of yourself and let the other person be sure of themselves. That's what politics is about. I am saying that I am sure.
Why should anyone vote for you?
Because I have a track record.
Which is?
And because I will not lie to people. I will not steal from them. Okay? I'll make sure that the right things are done in area of education, in area of local governance, in area of the health system. There are certain areas that I cannot sit back and watch, you know, just descending to the lowest level.
You say you have a track record. What is this track record?
Capability. I've never run a country before. But I have determination and I have capability and expertise in certain areas.
Which areas?
Why do you want me to tell you everything?
But why not? Somebody is watching you, wants to vote
education,
for you, wants to know what capabilities you have.
Education. Mm-hmm. In the health system, I'm not a doctor, but I know the areas that we can tweak to make the health system work better than it's doing today. Okay? Even infrastructure. There's a lot being, you know, spoken about. We're building roads, we're building houses. For me, it doesn't matter to me. The people must be better off. Then you can tell me your infrastructure matters. If the people are not better off, your infrastructure means nothing. Because infrastructure, you've got roads, you've got skyscrapers. It is the life of the people, it's the welfare of the people that should show whether we can actually relate it to your infrastructure. Otherwise, it's of no use to anybody. Are we going to eat the roads? No. But the people must have a better standard of living, a better lifestyle in their health, in their education, in their everyday life, housing, so that your infrastructure will make sense. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense.
Okay. If you're just joining us, this is an Upclose interview with the founder and flag bearer of the NDP, Nana Konadu Agyemang Rawlings. We're talking about her party, why she wants to be president of this country, her vision for the nation. We're just 5 months to go for the elections. We'll go for a quick break. When we come back, we'll analyze what this vision is and what to expect, also considering preparations that are going on for these elections. Is she satisfied and what should the future be for Ghana today? Details after the break. Stay with us.
I
plastic is working good for you.
I can see that. Okay, you can sit down now.
Dancing with her, but I did a poor job with it. But she's promised to dance for us before we end the show today with any song that she'd want here on the program. But thank you for that dance.
Nice one.
I'll come for some dancing lessons sometime.
You don't need it.
I have to. No, okay. It wasn't too good.
I want to start a dance school, and then really? I'll invite you. I'm working on it. I'm serious.
Okay.
Because I think guys don't know how to dance with ladies now, and it's not good. Yeah.
Maybe we didn't get the basics before.
Yeah, it has to be. You have to learn.
Go back to basics.
Absolutely.
That's fine. Okay. So let's talk about one of the key things that you're very passionate about, the 31st December Women's Movement. How's it doing?
The movement, being an NGO for women, has chalked a lot of successes, and one of the biggest, I'll say the greatest successes, is like having a child. The child grows up, and then you teach the child certain skills, and they become independent of you. It means that you've done your work well. Mm. If the child holds on to you, wherever you go, the child is following you. You haven't done a good job. So for me, at the moment, a lot of the women are doing things on their own. We still try to find out what the groups are doing. Some are doing shea butter, some are doing the gari, the oil, some are doing making, you know, they are running some of the schools and so on. I do keep in touch with them, but I don't go to them as regularly as
I used to. Is it as vibrant as it used to be?
It depends on what you mean by vibrant. Because when you're starting something, you need to go there all the time, be there, live with them, sleep there. I was doing those things.
Okay.
But once it picks up and you've got a project for them, because the thing is multifaceted, you know, we've got the economic activity, the political activity, because for me, every woman must be able to make an informed choice. So if you understand the politics, then you can make an informed choice. And then there's a social aspect. Then there is the cultural aspect. So we have these four pointers, and we use all of them to develop the women. And so it's doing well as entities. As a collective, we have to keep going there and so on. I have cut back on that for two reasons. The first reason being they are doing well, so they don't really need me that much. But there are other areas that I need to go to and talk to them about. You know, credits, how to take a little bit of money from here or there, how to pay it back, what to use it for, using it judiciously, and so on and so forth. And having a group that actually will influence each other, even as they are paying up the monies. Mm. So yes, I do go to some of them, but not, you know, just running from place to place, just explaining to them why it was important to have something to do.
Okay, okay. Mm-hmm. That's for the 31st December movement and women empowerment in the country today. Are we doing enough?
I don't think so. I don't think so. As I said on one of the stations, you know, we can take four steps in the area of women's empowerment, because this leader is really interested in empowerment. And then the next one comes, and he or she may not be interested in empowerment, but will say, I'll give positions to some women, and that should cover me for the rest of my time.
Okay.
So I think we could be doing more.
Much better.
Much, because we are 52% of the population. And you guys who are 48, please,
we should
allow
space.
Us, yes, give us space to grow.
Okay.
Give our children space to grow. The girl child, give her a chance to grow.
Okay. Now, since you're seeking to lead this country, I need to ask for the assessment of the country we are in today. Is the country being properly run as we speak in terms of our fight against corruption?
You know, I have said in a number of places that what is happening today smacks of somebody who is so careless with their lives that they don't really care whether what they're doing is good or bad, because they have no sense of right and wrong. And when it's like that, it's a difficult situation for the people to assess. I do not think that corruption is being fought at all. I don't think so.
You think the president has not fought it well enough?
I don't want to get into the presidency. You see, because it limits it to one person. Mm. And I don't like that. because it's generally the governing group, general. And so I don't want to zoom in to one person.
Okay.
Because there's a lot going on with a lot of them, which is very bad. And because of that, it is creating serious problems for the people of this country to be able to stand on their feet economically.
Okay.
Things are very, very difficult.
All right. Now, you say that we have not fought corruption at all. And then I need to ask you, because there's been a running story that's been with us for quite some time now. It's about the controversial gift. I'm sure you've heard about it, haven't you?
The what?
The controversial gift, the Ford expedition given to the president by a Burkinabe contractor.
Yeah.
Have you heard about it?
Yes, I have.
What do you make of that?
I think that in any instance, if I'm going to give you this for you to give me that, and I'm in a situation of power and influence, it's wrong. It's wrong. If I'm not in a position of influence and you have brought me this, I haven't done anything, you've given me this, okay. That is not trying to influence me. But once you give me something in return for another thing, that is wrong.
In this case, what do you think it is?
Well, I've just given you the instance.
Mm-hmm.
Are you telling me you're not thinking?
I don't want the instance. I want a very specific answer to it. I'm saying that the president has taken a gift. What do you make of it?
No, it's not just a gift, is it? Mm-hmm. You see, I don't want people to mix things up about it's a gift. Really? From what we heard from, is it Joy FM? Yeah. They said it was in exchange for a contract. And that is serious. If it's a gift that he's sitting in somewhere in Bole, and somebody says, oh, I'm giving you a car. He's of no interest to the person. The person just arrives from Burkina, wherever he comes from, and gives him a car. Even he's going to be surprised and say, well, why are you giving me a car? Even he will be surprised. But if it is given in exchange for something, it is influence. It's not just a gift.
So are you in support of the calls and the petitions that have been sent to Shraj for an investigation to be done on this?
Actually, I haven't read it.
Okay.
And I'm not aware.
Okay.
Yeah, really, I'm not aware.
But petitions have been sent to Shraj.
But the point is, it is wrong. It is wrong. Anything in exchange for something is wrong. When you're in a position of power, it's wrong.
And it should not, I mean, so the president should not have taken it?
I don't think so. I think you should have been the first person to say, hey, listen, you're looking for a contract, go through my, you know, don't bring anything to me. I remember my father, when people used to bring him gifts in the house, he would shoo you out of his house.
Mm.
He would tell you, no, you're not getting this, because they've got a bidding. If you win it, you win it. If you don't win it, tough. Don't bring me anything in exchange for that contract, because you won't get it if it's not yours.
Have you seen any of this happen in the time of your husband as president?
It probably happened. You mean my husband as an individual, as a person?
As president, when
he was
president.
No, I'm not aware. I'm not aware. You
nothing
can draw,
like that.
You can, no, I'm not aware. You can draw my attention to it and I can, you know, I can check.
Okay.
Yeah.
But nothing like that happened?
No, I said I am not aware.
You're not aware?
I'm not aware. And he's not the kind of person who will say, I've given you this and I'm taking that.
Okay.
No.
Because there was a case that was mentioned of Eddie Annan giving a gift to the president at the time, Mr. Rawlings. That became a big issue, I remember.
Did he do him any gifts? Did he do him any favor? I think it was his 50th birthday. And then he bought him a Buick. I think it's, I don't even know where it is now. Yeah, that is true. But he didn't even know who Mr. Annan was. He didn't know him. I knew Mr. Annan. But my husband didn't know who he was. So when the car came, he was asking me, who is it? And I said, oh, he's a businessman in town.
Mm. So if in that instance, later on, something like that came up, I mean, in principle, would you have asked him to send it back?
Well, in principle, if it is because he did a favor in return for that car, definitely it's wrong. It's definitely wrong. But if he didn't do him any favor or favors and he brought him this on his 50th birthday or his 60th, 50th, I think there's
in the maybe in the hope of getting future contracts.
Oh, no. I think that is also wrong. in the hope of. No, that's wrong.
Okay, all right. So, generally, with the country as it is now, what is wrong with how the country is being run? Because you want to be president, you want to change things. What are you hoping to change?
Francis, there are a number of things that I want to change. One of the major ones is to look at the educational system and make sure that when kids come out of school, there is some employment for them. It's not everybody who will get a job at the same time. But there should be a future where they can say that, okay, I'm applying for some jobs. Maybe within the next 6 months or a year, I'll have a job. But whereas where a country's economy is at its lowest ebb and businesses are folding up, businesses are leaving the country, they are throwing workers out, that the taxes are making the businesses impossible to run, they are drowning in taxes and in taxation. The electricity, the water, all these things are not helping businesses to actually thrive. They're actually moving into small countries like Togo. Why would anybody want to move to Togo? Ghana is the place. Why are they moving from Ghana to Cote d'Ivoire and Burkina and Benin? It shouldn't be so. So these are areas that I would like to tackle. Because if we can get those things corrected, then the children who are coming from school, with whatever backgrounds they have, if they don't have the background that can put them into industry, we can then talk to the industry people to help us in the planning of their curriculum to see what we should teach them for them to be able to get into the universities or get into the businesses, you know? And so it's all, intertwined. It's not just the economy, it's the businesses, it's the education, it's employment. One rolls into the other. So I cannot say this one and leave it at that. No. It rolls into one another.
Okay. Now, speaking of what you've been passionate about women's empowerment, last Saturday was exactly 1 year since Madam Charlotte Osei was appointed the EC chair.
Really?
Yes. What's your own assessment of her job in the past 1 year? Are you satisfied with the way she's done?
Francis, I have never thought of assessing somebody who, in my view, is not within my purview to assess. However, I can just say that with the way she's working and the issues that have come before her and the way that she's only the chairman, actually. She's not the electoral commission. She is the chairman of the commission. But she can direct it in a positive way. I think that she has to be a little more proactive, a little more of a listening person, somebody with a heart, we call it Abadai womb, so that you can feel what the people are feeling about the electoral process. And then use technical situations and technical issues to actually deal with us in that respect. Mm. So I'm not going to sit here and assess her, no. But I can sit here and say, well, in this area, she could have listened a little more.
Which area?
Like branding, rebranding. an institution that was not the most necessary thing to do at the moment. It's not, because we're looking for money from our collaborators, the donor countries. So they will sit back and say, well, they're looking for money from us to go and do what? To redo their logo? Really? Do we put our money into that? And we're going to have to change our letterheads, change our letter format, information, change a lot of things because of a logo. Obviously, we don't know our priorities, because priorities set, you should not be looking at logo. You can say, in 2 years, we'll look at this logo. But for the moment, because we have the elections in November or December, I don't know when anymore, we must make sure that the structures on the ground that will allow us to have a free and fair election is being done. Don't deviate from the issue of free and fair elections and dump us into some logo that everybody starts talking about. A logo. Is that the most important thing for us as a nation? Logo? No.
What about the issue of the voters register?
You know, I was telling a gentleman about a month ago on a station like that, like this, that I know what MPP has brought, but the other parties also, others have their issues. I have a first-hand information about Queen Mothers, two, one from the Asin area and one from the Gomua area, who called me and said, Ma, please, I'll say it in Fanti. Can I?
Sure.
One year, Bibi were at the was the bad season, Crawford Bugu had be one vote to her. Crawford Sukasa Crawford, and I and Tassi. Now, what's the hand one register? Now, her husband will be vote. Into no, yeah, then I said, go to the police.
So people had come there, brought people to come and register.
Yes.
That didn't happen.
Uh-huh. In central region and in western region. So I personally advised them on what to do. At the end of the day, when it was time for the voting, they were calling me. Yeah, you see, nothing was done. Those people have come back again with their buses to come and vote. And I said, go and report them. I mean, because I'm not there.
And did they
so
say
I'm just using
which,
it
which people brought them? Did they say?
No.
At all?
No.
Okay.
They're just saying people have come to come in. And they've come with, at that time, they said they've come with National Health Insurance Card.
Okay.
That's why I know that the National Health Insurance Card thing is a fact. I know it's a fact.
How should we deal with it, looking at the time we have left?
I don't think that it's in my purview to interpret a Supreme Court decision and an explanation by the Supreme Court. No person other than the Supreme Court can tell us what to do, and they've already told us.
Could they say I find out themselves better in us getting to this point?
I think so. I think that they were taking Ghanaians as suckers.
As
for,
what?
For suckers.
Okay.
You do understand the word,
yes.
Yeah? Like a runover. And so it's like we can do what we like, and what can they do? They can't do anything.
Mm.
But when you are being paid with the taxpayers' money, you have to be a little more careful than that, than just poo-poo everything we say away. So the Supreme Court has spoken. They have said that it has to be done. EC says they know the numbers that voted with the NHIS card. And it's very simple. They are saying, delete those names and maybe start registering people again. I don't know.
Okay. Now, there's one thing that's come up strongly, and I want you to clear it up because it's been running through in the kind of conversations that have happened. Some say you've been very critical of government, of the NDC. Even some have suggested that you are in bed with the MPP. Have you heard of that?
I hear it all the time.
What do you make of that?
I'm not going to let anybody run my political identity for me. I won't do that. And I'm not going to listen to people who are politically myopic to chart a course for me when I know where I'm going.
Mm.
I'm not going to let them do that. That's it.
Okay, all right. Final word, and it's in relation to your bid to become president. Mm. You met Hillary Clinton during your time as First Lady when she came with President Clinton to Ghana?
Even before.
Okay. Now, with both of you gunning for pretty much the same goal now, presidency, are there things you learn from each other as you look to lead your respective countries?
Well, I think that it's possible to learn from each other because I've heard her talk about things that I've discussed with her about how it takes, in Ghana, it takes a family to bring up a child. A whole village will bring up a child.
Mm.
Not just a family. Sorry, it doesn't take a family, it takes a village. Because everybody's issue is somebody else's issue or problem. And I've heard her saying it repeatedly on her rounds, that she wants America to see the children of America as everybody's child.
Okay.
And that it takes a village to bring up a child. So for me, that's good. So she's learning that from us as a nation. I'm also learning some things from her as an individual, from the social and political aspect of how to push certain aspects of
Do you think Ghana is ready for a female president?
I think it's the wrong thing for you to ask me.
Why not?
Because you are just a minority, 48%. I should be asking you whether you guys should be running this country. We are 52%. Why are you asking me?
Because in our history, it hasn't happened before.
It doesn't matter. You are only 48%. We are 52%. So allow us. We are not going to dominate you. Trust me. We are 52%. And we're going to make sure that this country becomes a better place to live in.
Okay. All right. Final word. Is the NDP done fighting with the NDC over its logo, the umbrella?
Oh, it's not the NDP that is fighting it. This is my case.
Okay.
Just me.
Are you done?
It was even before we set up the NDP.
Are you done with it?
It was before we set up the NDP. I've moved on. I'm doing... This is my emblem.
So you're done.
Why are you interested in done, done, done?
Done with the umbrella.
Oh.
That logo.
You are asking about the logo.
Yes.
Go and look at the registration.
It's done. It's this one.
This is our registration.
Okay.
But whether, you know, the other one is done or not, I leave it to them.
You leave it there.
This is my logo. So, Francis, what again?
I'm just curious. In 2012, you didn't get to contest for the elections.
For obvious reasons.
Who did you vote for in 2012?
Who did I vote for?
Yeah.
Politically?
President.
Presidential.
Yes.
And...
presidential first. We'll talk about parliamentary.
Excuse me. Presidential and parliamentary.
Yes.
Did you hear what the NCC was saying during my husband's time when we started the NCC?
Mm-hmm.
Your vote is your power.
Yeah.
Your vote is your secret. Did you ever hear that?
Yeah, I heard it.
Did you learn it?
Yes.
Well, okay. So my vote is my
secret. So you won't tell me?
No, I won't.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon.
Oh.
To sharing with us your thoughts on where you want to take Ghana to and where you're hoping to make it. But you promised you'd dance for us, right?
Well, unless you're dancing yourself.
You?
Unless you're dancing, then I'll dance.
I will dance with you. Why
okay.
not? So you, right. do you still
Why
want
do you want us to dance? Say, we are seriously talking about issues.
But we're done. We're done talking with it.
Yeah, but we've danced once already, so my people are going to think I'm not serious.
Oh, no. But they know you love to dance with everything. So I guess we can end the interview with that dance and read some of the comments that have come up on social media. Dr. Rhymes Dixon says, I like her ambition. She surely is a role model to many ladies out there.
Thank you.
Just like her husband, she has so far been the most influential first lady of Ghana. I wish her good luck. Emmanuel Teta says, says, is Ghana for Rawlings' family?
No,
your husband
at all.
Was president for 19 years.
Not at all.
And you two want to? The question he's asking is why?
Why doesn't he also join? That would be good.
Nwemete Ebete says, what is her view about the way our ladies that are being appointed to hold high positions are being bastardized by politicians? Okay. That's Nubote's view. Benjamin Annan says it's good for her boldness and courage for the presidency, but she will not come near the parliamentary seat, neither will she say that she will. In fact, okay, someone thinks that you have to forget about your presidential ambition.
Why?
Says just saying that you should.
Because he's a
Gilbert,
man.
Gilbert asked about what your view is on the president's Ford gifts. Bribe issue. I think you've already answered that issue. Demang Nelson says, Mom, we all love you and hope
Thank you
will throw all your weight on the MPP. God bless you. Mahamadou Badim Suglu says, I wish her all the best in
Thank
her
you.
Presidential ambition. Right.
Thank
then.
You.
So those are some of the views you sent us here on the show. A bit more of them right about now. Ofori Mesa says, oh, okay. All right. That's your view. Barnabas Sampa says, all right. Abdul Karim Superior says,
hey, Superior.
Is that's his name on social media, says, she doesn't agree. He doesn't agree with your view to become president of the country.
Well, that's his view, actually.
Yes, that is his view. That is his view. I guess I need to ask also, since you are a very political person, let's stay with that issue of, the political element in your family.
Mm.
I've always been meaning to ask this question. Which of the two men is more fun? And you will know better than anyone else. Jerry John Rawlings, Mr. President, or Mr. Rawlings, the retired statesman? Which of the two is more fun?
He hasn't changed.
At all?
No, he hasn't changed.
Nothing at all.
Well, I mean, he's grown older. So mm-hmm. have I. But his passion is the same. His feeling for people is the same. Mm. His strictness the same. He hasn't changed much. Yeah.
Nothing much.
Nothing much. Yeah.
Do you still crack jokes and laugh together? Take walks as well?
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah.
How often?
How often?
Yes.
As often as one needs. If I go, if I see him every day and we need to laugh, we'll laugh.
Okay.
If there's something serious and we're talking about it, we're serious.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Let me read some more of the comments that are coming in. Ahmed Kasim says, Amada, as you know, the youth of today are jobless under the current administration, despite numerous promises by the government. We are now tired and frustrated with the current administration. What is your word of hope for the youth? Because in his view, they are now hopeless.
It's very sad. For me, I believe that there has to be a collaboration between industry and the higher institution, and also between skills development and the middle level, you know, those who finish, let's say, SSS or GSS. We need to set up an apprentissage, an apprentice system, a skill development system. Mm. Some people call it vocational. Vocational appears to be a little lower, but skill development, I think, takes a different level. So that even if the person cannot enter a certain job market, they can still start working on something that they are interested in.
Okay.
The whole educational system will have to change. I think we have to look at it again.
Okay.
And then the teachers also have to be, you know, looked at.
Now, who will be your running mate in this year's election?
Oh, we thought we were going to surprise everybody.
Mm.
So
when will it be?
Maybe in the next 2 weeks or three.
In 3 weeks' time, we should expect your running mate.
Don't give me a...
I said
within the next 2 weeks or three.
So it could be earlier or post that time?
It could be post that time, yeah.
Post that time.
Yeah.
Will it be a man or a woman?
I think we'll get to that bridge and cross it when we need to.
Mm.
Get to the river and cross it. It will be good for us to have a balance of genders. However, if two men can always do the job, two women can also do the job. However, I mean, we'll look at it. It's not just up to me.
Mm.
It's up to all the executives, and maybe they will not agree with me. So.
Okay. All right. Right. So I guess we're done. Thank you so much for joining us.
You're welcome.
We will end with a dance
that
you promised me.
Oh,
with.
Dear.
Daddy Lumba will let us have that dance here.
I thought I did a dance.
That was just a little bit. We can do a better one to wrap up. Daddy Lumba, Machi Dede, which one do you want? I want it to be your choice, so we can have it in
Okay, we've done Lumba already, so please give me Amachi Dede,
Amachi
so he doesn't get
yes.
upset.
Amachi
and please,
do.
They should stop spelling my name with a G.
Yeah, too much of it. No G.
Yeah, the G is for Nana Agyemang, the Minister of Education.
Okay, yours is without a G.
Without a G.
All right.
It's an N, man.
Sure, I'm sure they will do the correction in
thank
due time
you.
For everyone
thank
else.
You very much.
But thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Amachi is taking us off. We can break
baby,
now
baby,
and
baby.
Scores, but we'll dance. It's to take you off now.
They should have given us Debbie Debbie Baby.
You want Debbie Debbie Baby?
Yes.
We don't have that now, but I guess we can manage this one.
All right.
We can, can't we? We can?
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay. Let me try and dance with, let's see. I have to come for the lessons.
I will give you the lessons. Don't worry.
Oh.
I've taught my son how to dance very well.
Really?
Yeah.
He's a good dancer, eh?
Very good. All the girls too.
They do?
Yeah. Because we were taught to dance.
Okay.
Dancing lessons. Every my children,
mm-hmm.
I think every anytime actually,
anytime.
But yeah, I didn't do it on a formal basis.
All right. Okay, we'll break for sports now here on the Pulse. Stay with us.
Don't let me miss that. Okay, thank you.
Oh, okay, you got it. No sports. Oh, I didn't know there was no sports.
You see? There he is.
Yeah.
Yes, I'm back.